Hey students, Nate Scharf here, your instructor with our second lecture, Chapter 1, Economics. So our first lecture was on accounting, where we were getting granular on a business's evaluation of their financial health and the financial statements and ratios that they use to monitor their financial status. With economics, we're stepping back and taking the 10,000 foot view and looking at things that are down the line and large macro trends that a business needs to monitor to be aware of where they're going to need to be in the next 6 months, 12 months, 2 years, etc. So same as the first lecture, you've got your key terms. Now to access, if you want to have the key terms links open up for you in the lecture, I provide two versions of the lecture in the resource page on Canvas. This video lecture, obviously, the links don't work in a video, but I also provide a slides-only version, Google Slides version, of these lectures, and you can open up that version to click on the OER links there as well. Of course, your OER links are also in the resource page for each week of the Canvas course. You also have the study guide, so I strongly encourage you to reference the study guide often. Most important about the study guide is that it highlights the key terms that are going to be on the exam. So the study guide is your friend when it comes to taking exams. Make sure you have it pulled up when you take an exam. Make sure you understand all the highlighted key terms that are on the study guide. So the study guide link is also provided in the Start Here module at the very top of your modules view in Canvas. And when you go to those resources under Start Here, you'll see a link to the study guide. So we're talking about economics and the career piece to this, the work-based learning is being an economist. And you can see some of the information here. Again, this is pulled specifically for North County, San Diego. As far as growth rate, it does project to grow at 6.3% as a career. It does pay better than accountants with a median of 84,000 plus. And you can see some of the companies locally that are hiring for this position. So what are the skills required to be an economist? Obviously, very good with data analysis, but more importantly, it's also the ability to take the macro view and be strategic and have long-term thinking and strategic thinking that the company executives can turn to their chief economist or the economist within the organization who can tell them what's going to be happening with the economy over the next year, 2 years, etc. It's not common to have an economist within a company. Large companies like Google has a chief economist. Certainly in the government, they have lots of economist positions, but many companies rely on reports from the government, from economists to make their decisions about. But you can see there are needs for them here. And you know, you'll see these probably also more in, if you look at this list here in San Diego, you see some governments and cities requiring that, but also some defense contractors and tech companies as well. So when we talk about economics, I'm sure you've had some exposure to economics through high school and where you learned about supply and demand and the invisible hand as described by Adam Smith and kind of the father of capitalism, which is the economic structure that we live under, which is the right to own things, but also competition and financial inequality of wealth. But what I want you to capture from here is the macroeconomic and the microeconomic. So macro is broad and is typically a country talking about their overall performance numbers from an economy standpoint. We're in an election year, so you hear a lot of political pundits talking about the economy. The economy is down, GDP is down, unemployment is down. These are all economic metrics and numbers that they use on a macro level to evaluate how a country is doing. Microeconomics is looking at specific sectors, either geographically, like the San Diego economy, or by business segments, like how is tech doing versus retail? And I'm sure we can all assume that retail isn't doing so great under our current pandemic. So macro is broad, micro is looking at specific sectors. Some of the metrics that they use to monitor the macro economy, and this would be each country looks at these things, GDP, gross domestic product, how much output in dollar value is a company producing. It's not necessarily imports, it's how much within the U.S. border defined, area are the businesses producing in that area. Recession, two or more consecutive quarters. There's four quarters, obviously, in a year. And if you have two consecutive quarters of negative GDP where production is shrinking, then we're considered to be in a recession. Inflation is the opposite, where prices are, there's too many dollars in the market chasing too few goods. And so we get inflation, which prices are going up. So for example, right now, the government has kept interest rates very, very low so that people will be enticed to purchase homes. And so very low borrowing rates. And the home market, despite the pandemic, real estate is actually really strong right now because of those low interest rates. But if you take rates too low, then there's too much money and spending and you start getting inflation where everything gets really expensive. And you've probably seen if you go to the grocery store that the prices for things are starting to go up a little bit. So that's inflation, when prices start going up. Obviously, employment level and unemployment, pricing, purchasing power, which is how far does your dollar go, and CPI and PPI is consumer price index, and PPI is producer price index. CPI is what are you and I as consumers paying to buy consumer goods. PPI, purchase price index, is what our businesses paying to buy their raw materials like construction, etc. The main thing you want to keep in mind here in my last sentence here is capitalism as an economic structure, it does require economic growth. So, and that's unfortunately impossible to sustain indefinitely. We've had periods of massive economic growth and loving capitalism, but eventually our economy contracts due to systemic shocks and other countries and things happening and pandemics. And capitalism as a structure doesn't do as well when our economy is in a downturn. Then you'll see the government stepping in and bailing out businesses. And then we get into a whole political discussion about what is that? Is that capitalism or is that socialism? And it's a key piece of the election right now is folks with fear about us being socialists and other folks saying, bring it on. It's better than what we have now. So there's a lot of different opinions on this, but my goal for you is that you have an understanding of kind of the basic economic structure. And I'll cover those in a second. This slide, the external business environment, I'm noting this for you because this is on the study guide and it's highlighted, ding, ding. So that means it's probably going to be on an exam. And when I talked about macroeconomic factors, this is an example of that. For businesses, they have to be looking constantly down the line and what do I need to be doing in the future to adjust my business so that we can survive. For example, right now, we're having a pandemic. It's not really a technology change. It's not political or legal. It's not even, but we are seeing the economy contracting due to the pandemic. So we have an economic shift. And you see definitions of each of these here, but companies are always looking down the line. For example, I'll give you a simple example. If your Yellow Cab, which is a taxi company that's been around since I was a little kid, taxis are pretty much done as a business. And I'm sure most of you would say, what's causing that? You would probably point to the yellow pie and say, technology, meaning ride sharing and Uber and Lyft has basically rendered taxis obsolete. So that's my point, is as a business, you have to be reading the tea leaves and know what's happening. Is there any pending legislation for me? I am Mark Zuckerberg, owner of and CEO of Facebook, and perhaps they're gonna, the government is going to start issuing some legislation to require that all my advertising gets monitored, which is something he's been fighting. Or maybe it's social cultural, like I imagine after the pandemic, people will be less interested maybe in driving to an office. There's more two-income families and cultural factors that are happening in society. People will likely be more sensitive to being around crowds, social cultural changes. Technology can render a business obsolete pretty quickly. If something changes very drastically, like right now, cybersecurity is pretty big, and many tech businesses are trying to figure out how to protect their stuff and their intellectual property. And if you don't have it, you're going to be rendered obsolete pretty quickly. And also, we have driverless cars coming down the pike, supposedly, or even I see companies that are pairing up for large drones, operatable drones that can work as sky taxis as well. So, you know, that could render airlines obsolete. So these are innovations that affect business. And then macro is like inflation, interest, currency exchange rates. That's where we get into the economic factors, and we're talking about the economics chapter. So to counter the pandemic, what is the current administration doing? They're keeping interest rates very, very low so that people are still feeling good about spending money because money's cheap right now and buying houses. And of course, competition is another factor that companies have to keep an eye on all the time. So know these four main pies: political, legal, social, cultural, technological, and economic. The other thing that you want to flag and that is going and make sure that you know, because it is going to be on the exam, are these different types of economic systems. And there's many slides after this, but I'm going to end here in the interest of being concise with my lecture time. And you can look at these slides in non-video format on the Canvas resource page. And I have a lot more additional information, things like the different types of unemployment and things that might be of interest to you. So you can look at those slides. And if any of those terms are of interest to you, you can always go to the OER textbook and dig a little bit deeper on those. But these are the four main types of economic systems: capitalism, mixed economies, socialism, and almost dead, communism. So taking going from the bottom here, communism, that's what we call a command economy, which simply means that the government controls all the factors of production. Basically, they run the economy. They decide what gets produced, how much of it. So the government does the production. Russia used to be communist, and communist countries are signaled by major shortages and overages of product, because they have a hard time monitoring supply and demand. You know, we have North Korea still, but communism as an economic system is mostly died out. Those that still identify as communist countries have moved more into a mixed economy. But so communism, the government controls all the factors of production. Socialism. Now, because you grew up in America in a capitalist society, if I was to tell you something such as, hey, at the end of the semester, we have about a third of the class that is not passing. They don't have enough points to pass the class. So I'd like to ask the students that have earned an A in the class, if you're willing to give up some of your points and give them to the students that aren't passing, It means you'll get a B or a C instead of an A, but it means that the students that are getting an F will pass the class. Basically, everybody passes the class. That is a rough example of socialism. So socialism is the government owns some essential components of the economy, like possibly medical and healthcare and utilities and transportation. It's signaled by higher tax rates, but more support for the citizens of the country. More guaranteed unemployment benefits. And it's more of an ideology, as in addition to an economic structure, is that folks who live in a socialist country, oftentimes, yes, we want everybody to be taken care of, even if that means I have to pay a little bit more in taxes. So for many folks in a capitalist country like America, that ruffles feathers and it doesn't even make sense. So that's the difference. A mixed economy is one that was formerly communist or socialist and is moving to where it's starting to be opening up its markets and being more capitalist. And we're certainly seeing that with a lot of European countries that were formerly more socialist. And some folks would argue, that the U.S. Has times when it bails out large businesses, maybe unnecessarily. Isn't that really socialism for large business? Whereas, the lower and middle classes is rugged capitalism. You're on your own kind of thing. So this is obviously a hot button for this election. And we see the polarity of folks like Bernie Sanders, who does want to move us into a socialist structure, and other folks who are diehard capitalists. Which brings us to capitalists, a true free market competition, winners, losers, and signaled by large inequalities in wealth. So there'll be people that are vastly wealthy, like Steve Jobs and Warren Buffett and Bill Gates, where collectively, they have, almost 80% of the country's wealth, and large amounts of poverty and folks that are poor. So capitalism doesn't necessarily equate to things are better for everybody. It does signal inequalities of wealth, but it is something we're based on as a country. Meritocracy, if you work hard, you can get ahead. That plays directly into a capitalist belief and structure. So I guess what I would say to you all is that economic structures are part ideology, part political, and part actual economic structures. And they move around a little bit. And what the future holds for the U.S. and other countries, we shall see. So the remaining slides, because I'm not going to talk beyond this slide, I'd encourage you to educate yourself a little bit further on these economic systems, specifically the isms. By there, I mean capitalism. Look at the rights of capitalists and kind of what signals a capitalist country, the right to own your own property, competition, versus socialism, higher tax rates, more government programs and support for citizens, versus communism, total command economy, the government dictates what is produced. So educate yourself. The following slides give you a little bit more information on that. I'm going to end it here, and you can always dive into the OER for more on this. Thanks for listening.